Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Caroline Kohles, and I am the Director of Health and Wellness at the Marlene Meyerson JCC Manhattan and Program Coordinator for Northwell Health's Edmund J. Safra Parkinson's Wellness Program here at the JCC. Welcome to Broadway's Best for Parkinson's. This program is supported by a community grant from the Parkinson's Foundation. I want to start by thanking the Parkinson's Foundation and all of our guests for being here tonight and for helping us get the word out about our Parkinson's programming. Anyone living with PD can participate from anywhere. We will put a link in our program about our program in the chat so that you can check out all of our offerings. Dr. Alessandro Di Rocco, Director of Movement Disorders at Northwell Health and our Medical Director of the Northwell Health Edmund J. Safran's Parkinson's Wellness Program is here, along with positive psychologist Maria Sirois, to talk about healthy hope tonight. And we have lots of Broadway stars in the house. Broadway musical director and actor author David Loud pre-recorded a conversation with his dear friend, four-time Tony Award winner Boyd Gaines, and they're going to share some funny stories about their time on Broadway, as well as how life is for them now living with Parkinson's. Boyd's wife, actor and theater educator Kathleen McNinney, will join David live to discuss the role of hope in caregiving. Don't miss our grand finale. As Emma Delasio and Nick Charney, the students of David and Boyd's at Manhattan School of Music, perform a beautiful duet and talk about what they are learning from David about hope. And finally, Valerie DiLorenzo, who's zooming in from Florida, and the director of Sing Loud for PD will close the show with a sing-along that you get to participate in. So for now, as they say, let's get the show on the road. My first guest is Dr. Di Rocco. Alex, as he prefers to be called, is an expert in Parkinson's disease and other movement disorders, and is a professor of neurology at the Zucker School of Medicine at Hofstra Northwell and system director Neurology, Parkinson's, and Movement Disorders at Northwell Health in New York City. Welcome, Alex, to the show.
Thank you. It's always a great pleasure to be with you and this great community.
We're talking about hope tonight, and I just want to thank you for being here. I'm looking forward to our conversation with positive psychologist Maria Sirois. She is back on the show to talk about the difference between false hope and healthy hope and kind of give us a context for how hope can be helpful when we're managing stressful times or living with a disease like Parkinson's, and how it can help us navigate not only the holidays, but daily life. And you were telling me, Alex, that you were thinking that this discussion was so important because whether we had, can you tell us, you shared that with me once, that you said, you know, we have to look at reality squarely in the eyes. Can you comment about that, Alex?
We were discussing about, you know, the concept of hope. And part of the discussion we had is that it's to be realistic and to be really aware of the reality and to just sort of really look at all aspects. And all aspects, in a certainly challenging life moment when you're diagnosed with Parkinson or you've been living with Parkinson for a number of years, is to sort of assess, like you do, like we all do in our lives, with or without Parkinson, what is it that is leading our life, that is giving us, you know, a desire to leave and looking forward, and what is it on the other hand that is a challenge straight on, and how do we balance this, and how do we are we honest about in our sort of outlook to life, without either denying or making a challenge something insurmountable when many times it's not.
Beautifully said. Maria, can you kind of give us some context, you know, spend a few minutes on hope theory and how that can help? And there's been misunderstanding about hope versus wishing or hoping something's going to happen. And there's actually a lot of science behind it.
Thank you, Caroline, and lovely to meet you, Alex, and hello, everyone. It's a delight to be back again with the Marlene Meyerson community. So interestingly enough, in the field of positive psychology, research has emerged that complements the research that emerged in the field of medical oncology a number of years ago, which has to do with an understanding of true hope versus false hope. So false hope is when, as Alex just so powerfully said, when we are in denial about reality being as difficult as it is, or denial about reality being as good as it is. Actual, true, healthy hope rests on the capacity to face reality directly on. I'm experiencing this, I'm thinking this, I'm feeling this, this has changed for me. You know, to really be sort of clear-minded and pragmatic about the consequences of living with a diagnosis such as Parkinson's, or being the care partner of someone living with a diagnosis. But that isn't the only reality. The other reality is our capacity to choose life, as Alex has said. I think the words you used, Alex, was to find the desire to continue living, right? And what we find, Caroline, is that those of us who activate a true grounded hope, not unrealistic, not fantastical, but true and grounded, do three things. We first face reality, the whole of it, the good, the bad, the difficult, and the wondrous. We pause and mindfully consider the third element, which is, what choices might I make? What action might I take to cultivate a slightly better future, which could be a slightly better afternoon, a slightly better conversation tomorrow, a slightly better holiday experience? And the person who gets to decide what that slightly better future looks like is the person themselves. So not the physicians, not the therapists, not the counselors, but the person themselves, the caregiver, the person living with the diagnosis, the best friend of the person living with the diagnosis. We all get to decide what that slightly better future looks and feels like. The last thing I want to say before I'll send it back to you, Caroline, is that hope, we think of hope as a feeling. It requires a belief that we can cultivate that slightly better future or get the assistance we need to do so. And it is known through action. So just imagining hope, thinking about hope, doesn't actually cultivate a more hopeful experience. We actually have to take action. We have to make choices that move that slightly better future closer to us. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. And Alex, would you say that as a neurologist, that when you see people taking action, small steps, incremental things to help advocate for themselves, that it makes a difference in the outcome when they're living with Parkinson's?
I think it's very true. And I think that Maria's definition, it really resonates for all our lives. I mean, I'm thinking of my own life, reflecting on my own life in this definition of facing reality and then sort of posing and looking at, I think it was a key word Maria used, is sort of a incremental, slightly achievable changes that you can make. I cannot imagine, we can all fantasize about, you know, some perfect life. But it is that next step that we can make that makes a difference. So one challenge in Parkinson is regarding the third point that Maria makes, is about action. One of the challenges a lot of people we have with Parkinson is that Parkinson itself, on one hand, diminish some of the physical abilities to make those even incremental changes. My incremental change may be to take an additional class or to do something for my physical well-being. Well, it may not be so easy if I have Parkinson. An additional element, which also we discussed, is that part of the disease or consequence of the disease many times is that depression and a very insidious sort of manifestation of disease, which is apathy. It's integral in many people's lives with Parkinson. And so that additional element is something that people with Parkinson many times face. On the other hand, I think, you know, the same way as we started, you know, discussing these elements is a way to recognize some of the limitations. So to recognize, in addition to whatever psychological or whatever other limitation we may have, or economic limitation, to make whatever step, the hurdles there may pose by Parkinson's disease. And to recognize them is the element of pose, right, Maria? You pose and say, okay, those are the challenges I have. How am I going to go about this?
You know, in the medical field, from the psychological perspective, we talk about the healthiest of us, and I'm now talking about internal psychological health. The healthiest of us live in what we call a state of dual awareness, that we prepare for the things that might happen, like increasing apathy or decreasing physical ability or increasing levels of fatigue, for example. We prepare for what might happen. At the same time, we hold the other awareness. And yet today, I'm in this place. And from today, from this place, these are the choices I can make. So we both prepare for what may happen and live in the present. And it's that dual awareness that keeps us grounded. And, you know, I'm thinking of the holiday season now, how that just layers in all sorts of complications and expectations and memories of what didn't go well and the fantasy of what might go well. And the healthy of us, wherever we are in the holiday season, prepare for what may happen and live in the present moment.
Yes. Oh, thank you for saying that. And I think that it's going to be interesting. Our next guest is actor David Loud. He's the feature of our show tonight. I know that he just popped on. I'm wondering if he can is ready. David, are you ready to jump onto the show tonight?
Absolutely. Yes, I'm here for you.
Oh, fantastic. You've heard Maria and Alex talk about, you know, the reality of looking at PD sort of square in the eyes, and then also finding what you can do every day in the moment. And Alex, I've heard you say that some days Parkinson's wins, right? Do you want to comment on that? And David, can you sort of tell us what it's been like for you in relationship to that, that hope takes action?
Well, I know that it was just so interesting for me to hear you talk about apathy and the inability to do something to help you get better. Because I found myself with that so often when I was first diagnosed. And just hearing that that was a symptom made it easier for me to move past it. I thought it was something wrong with me before I understood that it was something that was happening to me because of the Parkinson's. And I guess what I wanted to say about that is that knowledge about the disease makes it so much easier to deal with, in a way. My initial instinct was to ostrich and to put my head in the sand and let everybody else worry about the details. And but hearing about the things that were happening to me made it much easier to deal with them.
And Alex, do you find that that is one of the reasons that you sort of say, look at reality square in the eye, and you're honest with patients about what they potentially can experience?
I think so. And I think David was so explicit in saying that. And that's, I think, again, you know, reflecting on all our lives then, but listening to the experience of a lot of people with Parkinson, both the uncertainty, you know, the moments of diagnosis, you know, it sometimes, you know, it's the worst time it can be in a clinic is when I have to disclose, I'm sorry, you have Parkinson. And many times this comes with almost a sense of relief. It's like, now I know, now I understand what I have. And nobody welcomes that, of course. But then along the journey, knowing and understanding and recognizing, you know, the many different ways in which this disease can alter the function, but also the perception of life is important. And when you know, you better prepare. It doesn't make it necessarily easier, but you better prepare in dealing with it.
So well said. David, you actually wrote a book about your experience of being living with Parkinson, and also your experience as a Broadway musical director and actor and composer. And I've read your book. It's called Facing the Music, Broadway Memoir, and I've loved it. And I highly recommend it. I think Whitney just put it in the chat for everyone. And we're going to, in this book, you talk about when you were first diagnosed. And I think this would be a great time if you'd be willing to read an excerpt for us from your book.
I'd be more than happy to. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, Alex and I will be back.
Okay. I am sitting in an uncomfortable folding chair in an unpleasantly public hospital waiting room. The walls are gray cement. The bleakness of the hospital matches my mood. Curtains, the Broadway show I am conducting, has been running for 5 months. It's the happiest place I've ever worked, but the pain in my shoulder and the stiffness on the left side of my body have not gone away. 7 weeks ago, my physical therapist gave me the card of a specialist he thought I should see. I am an expert procrastinator, but I am finally here. I don't know what to expect. The receptionist, a graying woman dressed in gray, parked at a dark gray desk, looks up from her computer, which is gray, and says, "The doctor is ready, please go in." I walk into the neurologist's office. It is cozy and warm. The doctor looks up at me. He is quite old. White hair, a soft blur of a mustache, a kind face. He reminds me of someone. Who is it? "How long have you had Parkinson's?" he asks. I don't respond. "How long have you had Parkinson's disease?" he asks. The wizard. That's who he reminds me of. He looks like Frank Morgan, the actor who plays the wizard in The Wizard of Oz. "I didn't know I had Parkinson's," I say. As an expert in delusional thinking, I had actually thought I was coming to the neurologist to discuss my shoulder injury. "What's Parkinson's?" I ask. He motions for me to sit. My first thought when you walked into my office was that perhaps you'd had a small stroke or Bell's palsy. Your face is quite irregular. One side is droopy. But when I saw you walk toward me, I knew you had Parkinson's. "How long have you had it?" "What?" I ask. "This is going so fast. Why can't I slow it down?" "Parkinson's disease," he says, "is a neurodegenerative disorder that affects the brain cells in the substantia nigra, the brain cells which produce dopamine. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter. It helps communicate messages across different parts of the brain. The loss of dopamine in the brain can lead to movement problems. Symptoms can include tremors, stiffness in your body, and a slowing down of your physical activity. Your face may show little or no expression. One of your arms may not swing naturally when you walk. Your speech may become soft or slurred." I can hear everything the doctor is saying, but I have left my body and I'm looking down on the scene from high above. The doctor looks quite small, sitting at his desk. The younger man sitting across from him looks small as well. "There is no cure," he says. "Maybe I'll wake up," I think, from high above. "Maybe I'll wake up and feel that surge of relief when I realize it was all a dream and everything's okay. Please," I say to a God I don't believe in, "please, God, let this be an awful dream." "But there is a lot we can do," says the doctor. "There is medication which can relieve your symptoms. There are things we can do to limit further deterioration." Deterioration. Deterioration of my brain. 2 times 2 equals 4. 2 times 3 equals 6. These are too easy. 12 times 17. What is 12 times 17? "Do you have any questions?" he asks. "Yeah, I have a question. What the fuck is 12 times 17? 204. It's 204. Is that right? I sit silently. He sits silently. It's definitely 204. "What do you mean when you say my face is droopy?" I ask finally. "You haven't seen it?" the neurologist says, surprised. "The left side of your face has sagged. It's quite noticeable. Do you have a girlfriend? Hasn't she noticed?" boyfriend, I say, no, he's never said anything. You're kidding, he's never mentioned it? The doctor chuckles to himself. I don't know what to say. What do you do for a living, he asks. I'm a conductor, I say. I conduct Broadway musicals. Really? He's genuinely excited. What have you conducted? We see everything. I mentioned a few credits. Ragtime, he says, his eyes twinkling. You conducted that? Excellent. A little long, if you ask me, but what a cast. Audra McArdle. And Curtains with Dr. Niles Crane. So funny. We saw it a few weeks ago. Wonderful. What's his name, the actor? David Hyde Pierce. He finishes the name triumphantly. I loved his dancing. So funny. I offer up my most interesting credit, the truffle on the dessert menu. I was in the original cast of Merrily We Roll Along. He gets that holy look on his face. I recognize it instantly. A small portion of the human race worships Merrily unnaturally. Really, he says, visibly moved. He looks me in the eye. I wait for him to say, as God is my witness, I am going to cure you. Instead, he says reverently, I met Stephen Sondheim once. Why is this what we're discussing? His secretary, nice lady, was a patient of mine. Wait a minute, I know Steve's secretary. An alarm bell goes off in the back of my head, but it is drowned out by the other 19 thoughts roaring through my deteriorating brain. What do I do? I ask. He looks at me, perplexed. About the Parkinson's, I say. Oh, he seems disappointed. Back to business? I nod. The first thing, he says, we get an MRI to make sure a brain tumor isn't causing your symptoms. There's also a test I could arrange that involves injecting dye into your brain, but frankly, it's expensive, and I'm pretty sure you have Parkinson's, so I don't think we'll do that one, right? He looks at me as if I've had time to make an informed decision. I nod, dazed. I have all of the symptoms that you mentioned, I say. I have a slight tremor in my left hand. The left side of my body is stiff. I move more slowly. My left arm does not swing when I walk. And I have noticed my voice getting softer. He jots a few notes on his notepad. Clearing his throat a little, he raises his eyes up to mine. He looks like he's going to say something important. You know, he says, I have a grandniece who wants to be an actress. Very talented, sings like an angel. Maybe she could audition for you sometime. Jesus Christ. As appalled as I am, I confess I'm also thinking, sure, send the girl in to audition for me. Do I get better medical treatment? Put her in the chorus, I don't care. I am overwhelmed and not thinking rationally. I gather my things. I have to call Pedro. I have shopping to do. We have 40 people coming over for dinner. Today is Pedro's 45th birthday. The doctor smiles cheerfully as we say our goodbyes. And I stumble out of his office. The gray secretary looks up at me. I am so tempted to walk right by her, but because it's what I'm supposed to do, I make a follow-up appointment and schedule an MRI. Then I go outside to call Pedro. I sit on a bench in the Park Avenue median. He answers the phone. The neurologist says I have Parkinson's, I say. It starts to rain.
Thank you. Alex and Maria, I know you both have had to, you know, tell clients, patients, friends when they've had a diagnosis. And this story is gut-wrenching. I'm sorry you had that experience, David.
Well, it was shocking at the time. I find it comical now that it was so abrupt and horrible, and in a way there isn't a good way to hear it, so I don't know.
Maria, in relationship to what we're talking about, which is facing reality and having sometimes in our human experience people that don't handle us with the most gentleness or compassion. How do we recover from that? How do we face reality and then move on? Does hope play a part in this?
You know, not initially. I have tremendous respect for David's willingness to be so honest about his experience and so beautifully poetic and articulate at the same time. And I'm imagining, and I don't know David at all, but I'm imagining that one of the things that helped you make sense of the moment over time was the capacity to put words to it, to make sense of it through language, because clearly that's a strength of yours. And Caroline, we find that those of us who are able initially to feel what we feel, to be in shock, to be confused, to want to walk past the gray receptionist in the gray room with the gray computer, you know, that those are all of our natural inclinations. And to feel that, allow, you know, full permission to feel what we feel and think what we think. And then leverage two important elements. One is our connections. You know, I'm calling Pedro. First thing I'm going to do, I'm going to call Pedro. Leverage our positive connections. And the second thing is, over time, activate those strengths that are always, have always been who we are and will always be who we are. So in David's case, humor, you know, making sense of things through story and activating the connections while continuing to think about, you know, how, I love the question you posed in the middle, what can I do to slow this down? You know, so coming into the present moment is a tremendous piece of wisdom as well.
And Alex, your thoughts?
My thoughts that, you know, to hear David narrate brings back many, many of the moments today when I had to sit and have that conversation. And it's certainly, it's a turning point. I mean, I had a patient today telling me that we met in 2009, and she told me that she remembers exactly the tie, the color of my tie, what was happening. It's like, and she defined it as a crime scene. Now, hopefully her experience wasn't as traumatic, but it is a moment of trauma. You know, is a moment in which someone tells you your life from this moment on. You know, it is 6:29 p.m. on December 14th, is changed. And you're sent, you know, no matter what, you into a different world, and there is a before and there is an after. It's probably as traumatic as a, you know, it's a loss, it's a trauma, is mourning. We started this discussion with hope, and I think that, you know, part of what we really sometimes forget is about how transforming and traumatic this can be. Now, it's a moment in which, you know, tears can come, or anger, or you know, I told you so, that some spouse can say, or a friend can say in the wrong time, whatever it is. But it's a moment of immense loss, and transform that. You know, I many times feel like to say, wait, don't go all the way there. It's the beginning of a new life for sure. It's a moment in which you're going to have to rethink, you know, whether your career and so on, you're going to start have to do some recalculation or recalibration in your life. But, you know, it's not the end of the world. In some ways, it's the beginning of a new world. Or maybe it is the end of an initial world, you know, as we imagine. You know, we imagine that, you know, we're going to grow and age in a certain way, and, you know, have all our, sometimes not fantasy, calculations about how life is going to be, and that's shattered. But on the other hand, it's a recalibration, as it is for many times, many things, many ways in which we have our life, whether it's loss
Alex, that is so well said. Maria, it reminds me of what in positive psychology, they talk about resilience. Can you just define that for us in this moment? And also, David, you turned to someone you loved, that you turned to, that is an action, yeah?
It's so interesting to hear it. You describe it as the moment of significant change in a life. And that's how I feel. That's exactly how I feel about it. And I can't think of many other times in my life that felt so definitive, that felt so, I mean, this was a negative one. So it had all sorts of consequences and fear attached to it. But we don't often have those defining moments in our life where everything changes.
Yeah. Rio, did you want to mention or talk about that? I know you've talked about one of your strengths is bringing hope into the darkest of places. And this is a story of like a dark time, a transitional time, and so beautifully written, David. How does hope or resilience help us in these times?
Well, hope is necessary, and it's not, I want to make sure that everyone listening or watching understands that no one would expect David to have held a sense of hope that particular day, or the patients who Alex spoke to today about receiving the diagnosis. Hope is not something that, it emerges out of the longing to resolve how terrible things feel when difficult things happen, but it takes time to emerge. And, you know, it's kind of a bridge between the moment that you receive the diagnosis and then the life you create after. Hope is a bridge, but it takes a little bit of time to get there. The resilient person is the one who gently starts making choices little by little, day by day, incremental choices that move them closer and closer to feeling, oh, this is very hard. And I still have work that's important to me. This is excruciating and people still love me. You know, I have no idea what the future is going to look like. And today there's a song I have to record, you know? So that's what resilient people actually look and feel like, that dual awareness of how terrifying or frightening or confusing it all is, and what's meaningful to them and how they can show up and the choices that are available to them in the present moment.
Beautiful. And one of the ways that you did that, David, was friendships. And we have in the audience a dear friend of yours. But before we go there, we recorded a conversation between you and your longtime friend and four-time Tony Award-winning actor, Boyd Gaines. In addition to sharing a journey on Broadway and teaching at the Manhattan School of Music, new young performing artists, you also share a journey with Parkinson's. So let's take a look at this conversation and then we'll come back. This is about getting to know you guys a little bit more and elevating your friendship. How did you two meet?
We cast Boyd as George Novak in She Loves Me, which was the first New York revival in 93. And it was pretty much love at first sight for me.
Me too.
Boyd came in and sang, and the director just said, that's it. That's got to be it. He was the perfect combination of actor and singer and avuncular leading man.
and goofy.
And goofy. And Boyd was a little unsure about his voice, but cool. To me, Boyd has the perfect voice for the part and that character. And he worked very hard and we had a great supporting cast. And it just, everything about that production was lovely.
What do you guys love about being on Broadway?
Just to be on Broadway, to walk into the theater district, go backstage, get ready to go is part of such a long tradition.
The run of a Broadway show is such a privilege and such a pleasure and such a communal joy, but it's also a marathon of routine and backbreaking work.
Just doing the show 8 times a week, you're constantly juggling health and repetition.
There was a point in the show each night when he would finish singing the song Tonight at 8, which is a fast patter song. And in the very last chorus of it, he had to climb up the stairs, and the orchestra was up on the second level. I was conducting from a keyboard on the second level. And the final beat of the song was Boyd collapsing, and his head would be about 6 inches away from my feet when he would collapse. And at the first preview, he had done a very good job. And I said, "That was great," in the dark after the song had ended. He said, "Thank you." And then he ran in the dark to get into his next scene or costume. And the next night, his head appeared at my feet at the end of the number. And I didn't say anything because it was equally great. And I didn't have another compliment ready. And Boyd came up to me at intermission and said, "Was it no good?"
It's the danger of praise mid-show.
Yeah.
But you guys have been friends for a long time now. How does that work? Because it's almost like a Broadway show is like a family, right? You all come together and you're sort of, as you said, 8 shows a week with these particular people. And then you have to leave and go on to your, you know, respective lives.
All productions are families, just sometimes they're very dysfunctional families.
I find that on each show, you take a few people with you into your life and hope that you can continue the relationship outside the show.
But you stayed in touch.
It didn't hurt that David's husband, Pedro, and my wife are fast friends and have met around that very same time.
Aha. So it's also a couple relationship. That's great. Did your wife marry David and
yes. Pedro?
The best day of my life.
Yeah, it was a joyous day, and had a bomb gone off at the wedding, it would have decimated the entire Broadway musical community.
Boyd and his wife, Kathleen, have become truly part of our family, whether we're working together or not.
And vice versa.
Yeah.
I've been so lucky in my career, and Boyd has been, you know, somebody who's enjoyed great success as well. And there's no guarantee that you get anything like what we've had in the business. And yet I've had as much frustration and rejection and disappointment as I have had success. In the theater, you know, the friends I've gathered are people who understand hardship. Our theater family seems so willing to give and able to give support and help is because they do understand in a way that life is never just happiness and success. It's always going to have challenge and disappointment and humiliation. It's very easy to go, "Well, why am I even trying? What possible chance do I have of continuing with on what was an already impossible route, now made more difficult?" But thus far, it seems like the right thing to do to keep going. I suppose at some point it won't be, but I think that's a ways off yet.
Oh, I think so. I wish anyone who has Parkinson's, I tip my hat to you for your struggles and wish you the best and hope you are able to find joy in your life still, as opposed to always worrying about what will come next.
Wow, David, that's an amazing interview moment. And I love when he says, "I hope you will find, you know, joy with what comes next." It really fits into what we're talking about. And I must say, it was fun to just get the inside scoop a little bit on Broadway and what goes on behind the scenes. And speaking of what's going on behind the scenes, we have someone backstage that is a special guest. I hear your wedding officiant is here.
Hello, Kathleen.
Nanny. And
hello, my love. How are you?
Yeah, it's just so great to have you guys together. Kathleen, you've heard this, Dr. Di Rocco and Maria, and of course this beautiful reading from David about his when he first heard that he had Parkinson's. And you've also, when did he first tell you, and was it a surprise to you? You know, you talked, David, about how the Broadway community and your friends know about hardship. So did you kind of just roll up your sleeves, or what happened for you when you heard this news?
Well, it was interesting because they didn't tell anyone for a while. And then when Boyd was diagnosed, I understood that, why that was. Because when I was told, of course, I just remember being devastated. Because first, I didn't know what Parkinson's was. So I immediately thought I was losing somebody. Mm-hmm. So first of all, Parkinson's is not going to kill you in the, like, you know, like the immediate future, with maybe somewhere way down the line, but it's a slow disease. And so I didn't know any of that. So my first, you know, I was overwhelmed. And I remember the process of maybe Debbie can talk about why they kept it. I know why we also waited a while to tell anyone, because there's a processing that you need to do for yourself before you suddenly have to deal with other people's, right, emotions coming at you, which are big and strong, right? David, would you say?
I was completely terrified. I thought that I would never work again. I thought that if people found out that I had this disease that was going to interfere with my conducting and my piano playing, that I would never work again. So I doubled down and tried to hide it and deny it. And it was a terrible 3 years that I did that, until it was just too ridiculous and I couldn't pretend that I wasn't compromised anymore. And people were so kind when I finally told them, and relieved that I was finally talking about it, and so eager to find ways that they could help. You know, if you can't conduct 8 shows a week, maybe you can supervise this. If you're not going to be playing on the show, maybe you could arrange something for us. I had wasted so much time worrying about what people thought. The fear was much more paralyzing than the actual disease.
Maria, I wonder if you could come back. I think that this is very normal. And if you could tell us about just that, the cycle of hearing news and what happens in our brain, or, you know, and how we have to process, and how that's so individual.
Yes. Yeah, so imagine any of us receiving news that is shocking, that puts us in that kind of moment where there is a definitive before and a definitive after. It's almost as if psychologically we experience a kind of concussion, and it takes time for the psychological swelling to resolve so that we can find ourselves living into a new normal. You know, for David, there's a process of time where things were falling apart, and at the same time, he was making choices that eventually cultivate living into a new normal, and not necessarily a comfortable or a clear normal, but things begin to, you know, sort of stabilize a little bit, not unlike our experience globally of navigating the fallout of the pandemic. Certain things that were true before the pandemic no longer are true for us, and new norms have emerged. And it's in this process of navigating what we've lost and are losing, and actually choosing the things, like eventually sharing the news with others, that help us stabilize in our new normal. That's the hallmark of resilience, is that we continue to bring closer and closer those choices that stabilize us.
And those transitions, they take much longer than people think. It's like people almost have an expectation, oh, I get the news and then suddenly I'm supposed to be okay with it. But what is the cycle of that? It's individual too, isn't it?
We're a little nutty about time in this country. We think we ought to be able to integrate loss in like a year, and we ought to be able to integrate news like a Parkinson's diagnosis within 3 to 4 months. And that's just a little unreal. It's a little nutty. Yes, everyone has a different sort of rhythmic clock in terms of integration of new information and recalibrating into a new normal. And it often takes much longer than we expect. It doesn't mean, however, that there weren't moments for David and Kathleen and anyone living with a diagnosis or caregiving for someone, that there weren't moments along the way that were lovely and softening and kind and meaningful, or that there weren't moments of great music in David's experience while he was experiencing fear and terror. And by the way, I love, David, that you don't soft pedal your experience, you know, that you just say, I was terrified and it took years, right? Because I do believe that for all of us listening, that kind of authenticity is actually helpful. It grounds us.
Yeah, it was. It's interesting because it's such a strange thing that my dearest friend, that David was doing a show, Boyd was in the show, they were down in DC, and David, I think you were about 9 years into your Parkinson's, and I had been tracking Boyd's tremor and been trying to get a hold of it. And then I said, I remember calling up Pedro and saying, God, I think Boyd has Parkinson's. He said, no, I mean, what are the chances of that? And he goes down and he watches the show and he goes, Kath, I think you're right. And so for me, my walk through this was very different than what it had to be for them, because I had support immediately. There was someone there. And we have a child who was just graduating from high school when Boyd was diagnosed. And in a great moment of tremendous compassion and love, when we also were not telling anyone right away, it was, again, going through this processing that's very difficult to go through. And yet our child was getting ready to go off to college and was suddenly terrified to go because she was worried about her dad. And David and Pedro took her out and said, you can ask us anything. You can talk to us about anything you're scared about. And told her that, I'm going to start crying, said that we're here to be with your parents. We got it. You go live your life. You're ready to launch. Go and don't worry. And it was one of the greatest gifts that has ever been given to our family, to our daughter. Really, it's a very moving gift that we were given.
Wow. Maria, you had your story with your brother, right? When he was diagnosed, and you said that you did one thing. What was it? You every day you looked for one thing that was beautiful about that day, and that helped you through that really challenging time.
So my younger brother was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer right around this time of year, actually December 16th, and then passed 10 weeks later. So it was a very aggressive, very difficult time. But I knew the research, and the research shows that resilient people acknowledge the pain and the suffering, and they integrate in even the tiniest little bit of good in their day. So one of the practices any one of us could take from this conversation tonight is to search for just one moment during the day to hold on to that was either beautiful or that you appreciate or that was soothing to you. Just one good moment. Could be the tiniest thing, like a particular bird's song that morning, and that's it. Hold on. And these moments, when we look for them, they begin to grow both in how they fill us, but also in the recognition that the good is still present even in the hardest of days. For Kathleen, for example, that great story of your daughter being afraid to leave, or your child, I can't remember if it was your daughter, I think it was, being afraid to leave, and suddenly, you know, friendship emerges in the most profound form. And some days the beautiful moments are extraordinarily profound, and some days they're quite simple, but every day, to cultivate the lens of appreciating the good is a practice of resilient people. And that's what helped get me through to the place where I could make sense of life again after the loss of my brother.
And that's really true. It's making sense of life again. Kathleen, how was that process for you, making sense of life again?
Well, again, I, 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 I can't stress enough how important community is, and the fact that I have one is, and there are other people surrounded by in my life that suddenly appear that have partners that are going through a similar, their partners are getting diagnosed with Parkinson's, and it's also theater actors, and we've kind of become this little support for each other. And it is, and now I'm hopefully helping someone else in the way that was, I was given this very specific help from David and Pedro at a time that was so startling is kind of the word. You just, you are kind of so off balance and you don't, can't quite find where ground is. And as a caretaker, it's a kind of a little bit different kind of balance because it's not your body that is going through the changes, and yet your whole life is suddenly changing very rapidly. And I would say, you know, this friendship, this particular friendship that I have is just so grounding. It's just, it just puts everything in perspective, and we can laugh together and we have a good time together. And I, you know, we're just really, really lucky to have each other. Yeah.
And David, you've expressed some concern sometimes that, you know, maybe Pedro is doing too much or being concerned about that. How has that affected your ability to tell him about certain things or your worry about that? Because that comes into play too.
Of course it does. And I mean, Pedro does do too much because he wants to help and he wants to solve problems. And
he does.
Solves every problem. Mm-hmm. He especially likes to solve problems by buying a gadget.
He does. And I buy everything that he buys. I go, oh yeah, that sounds, looks good.
That's great.
He loves to combine retail therapy.
Maria, I wonder, what about those folks out there, and Alex, maybe you can join too, that don't have a community, that are living alone with Parkinson's? Is there the science of resilience? If you're facing this diagnosis by yourself, certainly that's why the JCC is here, but we, that's a reality for a lot of people, or even if they are split from their partner. Maria, did you want to say something, then Alex? And I
absolutely. So we know that in times of transition, like receiving a difficult diagnosis, often we have the experience of whatever community had been available to us before kind of falls apart, and it takes time to cohere a new set of friends or a new set of people who understand our experience. And in those transition times, we want to be thoughtful about a couple of ideas to keep in mind. One is, there is never a bad time to become a better friend to oneself, to really center the day in terms of what works and serves and nourishes you. Secondly, sometimes, interestingly enough, in the most difficult moments, it's former connections who sort of rise, and to not be shy about reaching out to people who knew you back in the day in terms of what wisdom or they have gathered or what support they can offer. Third, absolutely, the Parkinson's Foundation, any of the regional and local support groups, community centers, and also, you know, my field, the counseling sort of field is available in so many different ways to help us continue to feel like we are being supported in the world. Every physician I've ever known in this domain has been asked the question, you know, how do I get help or who do I turn to? And many physician or physician offices have resources available also for you to take a look at and consider. And the last note I want to underscore here in terms of community is to not forget that many of us find comfort in the spiritual realm, whether that's actually participating in a faith community or, you know, attending church, temple, synagogue, mosque, but also just, you know, bringing one's soul alive in terms of conversations with that which may not be in body. And so to keep those doors open as well.
It strikes me that this living with Parkinson's really requires courage.
Yeah.
Right? That you have to make do things that you might not necessarily want to do, or if you're facing and dealing with apathy or depression that your body doesn't even want to do as well. Alex, in relationship to being alone in community, what do you have some thoughts? And Maria, thank you so much. I know you have to go for sharing your time with us. It's been just a delight as always.
Thank you, Maria. And I really second your words. Sort of at certain times when you need the community and you need to make sometimes an effort, because some people are now lucky to have the family and support that David and Kathleen discussed. And many people, yeah, we discussed that as part of our programs at the JCC in New York City in particular, where, you know, aging alone is the norm for maybe not the majority, but for many people. And aging with Parkinson can be really, really difficult. And add on, you know, all the elements that were discussed today, you know, the stigma, the you know, sometimes the sense of being diminished by the diagnosis. So even the process of reaching out to, you know, an old friend or someone that may be a support requires, as you Caroline said, a lot of courage. You know, there is a psychological courage that is sort of, even for me, difficult to imagine how you need to reconcile everything within yourself, as been said today, and then sort of enter this other world as a different person and sort of not knowing how the others are going to react. And the reality is that we have heard the sort of the best part, but again, looking square in the eyes, I've seen discriminations, as you heard, and as you, Caroline, and I'm sure others have seen. I remember sort of really being in disbelief when I heard people being fired because they had Parkinson's. I mean, they're not fired because of Parkinson's, it's obvious. People being, you know, left by their spouses or by their... So this is the other part of the reality about this, and it's real. On the other hand, I think this is what Maria was saying. Sort of, it's a moment of it's a moment in which, you know, you reassess your life, and reassessing your life means reassess your coordinates, those who are around you, and sometimes, you know, it's a good riddance to get to lose, you know, a friend who's no longer a friend because of your Parkinson. That maybe it's not a bad thing, but I think your point is true. It takes a lot of courage, and a strong, continued, relentless courage towards sort of an unknown redefinition of life. And what I think, though, Maria was mentioning, emphasizing, is that, and we may all have experienced that, is that there is a community that is more welcoming than we imagine. And there is a community that has more opportunities than we imagine. And every time, even personally, when I needed and felt the need of a broader embrace, I was amazed how incredible supportive life can be and people can be in different corners of our life. And certainly the JCC is meant to be that, and I think has been a family for so many people.
You say that often, Alex. You know, when he comes over to the JCC after being at the hospital, he's like, oh my gosh, it's just so different, right? And it's, you said it's a great juxtaposition in some ways, and it's a great compliment, right, to have those contrasts. And one of the things that helps, I think, a community program like ours is theater and art and music. And Kathleen and David, you both teach now. There's a different career, David, that you have, and we have even have some of your students here. How is it for both of you to transition from, you know, performing, which you still are to a certain extent, and then really be helping the next generation come up. Kathleen, you first, and then David, I want to hear from you.
I love it. I love it, love it, love it. I love my students. I think it's an incredible gift to be able to share space with young people and to watch them grow and to be a part of that. It's really special. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's true. And Marie, I know she would say, because I've heard her say it before, when we give back, when we give of ourselves, when we are connected, whether it's through volunteer or teaching or even just connecting to creating something, we are activating that hope circuitry too. David, how about for you?
And I would say, and the other thing I just want to toss in is that David is responsible for Boyd, helping him also make the transition to that when his performing life started to disappear and to teaches, yes, the same place. And David's, what can I say?
Oh yeah, David, let's have you unmute. There we go.
Our students are so lucky to have an actor of Boyd Gaines's experience and talent and knowledge as a teacher. It's just, I can't imagine a better source for young people to have as a mentor and to be able to consult about the business, about how to solve specific acting problems that they might encounter in a scene. And Boyd is just this wealth of experience and knowledge and wisdom.
And you too, my friend.
Well, speaking of sorry, David, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I never imagined being a teacher, but when Parkinson sort of directed me that way, I landed on my feet and I love it. To be around.
And this is what Alex is saying, right? It was a whole new life that, yes, there is an ending of sorts, but there also is a beginning. And as Maria so said, it takes longer than we think. We do in our cultures tend to think things should happen faster. And to give ourselves that time and to be patient, right, is so, so crucial. It seems to me, Alex, that you're part of you spend your time, I know I hear you do it, like, keep going. Have you gotten involved in that? Have you gone to the JCC? Let's join you every year. We're at the walk in Central Park. You know, you're actively engaged as well. Speaking of this, let's bring these young people on. I want the audience to meet them. Emma DeLasio and Nico Charney. Welcome you guys. You're currently sophomores at the Manhattan School of Music, working on their BFAs in music and theater. It's great to see you guys.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you for having us.
Wow, what's it like having two instructors that are so accomplished, but also have Parkinson's?
Well, we haven't had Boyd yet. I think we're going to have him around senior year, right?
Yeah, in the near future. So,
But me and Nico had David last year as our musical theater performance technique teacher, where we were able to learn so much new repertoire from him. And I feel that I've improved overall as an actress and a singer from taking his class. And then also in last month, I was able to do a production with him, She Loves Me, and he was the music director. And it was such an amazing opportunity to be able to be in a show with him as the music director, and I learned so much. And I'm so thankful for that experience.
Wow. Well, you guys have a special duet for us. Let's hear that now, and then we can come on back and talk about it.
Awesome.
Got the cutest little way. Like to watch you all the day. And it certainly seems fine just to think that you'll be mine when I see your pretty smile. Makes the living worth the while. So I had to run around telling people what I've found. And when I told them how beautiful you are, they You're in a class beyond compare. You're the loveliest girl that one could see. And when I tell them, and I'm certainly going to tell them, that I'm the man whose wife one day you'll be, they'll never believe me. They'll never believe me that from this great big world
so proud.
They are terrific.
Oh, thank you guys so much for joining us. What talent. We look forward to hearing and watching you on the Broadway stage or on any stage that you appear. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I have the pleasure now of introducing everyone to Valerie DiLorenzo. She is a award-winning actress and creator of Sing Loud for PD. David, have you heard about Sing Loud for PD?
I think I've heard of it, but I don't know the details.
Yes, well, Valerie, tell us about it. And then we're going to get into the holiday spirit, or just the spirit of being together and creating community by singing our way off the show.
Thank you so much for inviting me. It's what a lovely, lovely way to spend a Wednesday evening. Everyone is great. So Sing Loud for PD is a singing chorus that was developed through the Stony Brook Southampton Hospital Center for Parkinson Disease, as well as the American Parkinson Disease Association. And we started this class I want to say about 6 years ago. And we started live out in East End of Long Island, in Southampton and East Hampton. And then, like everybody else, we had to pivot to virtual. and we pivoted virtually on May 4th of 2020. And so now the class is on Wednesdays at 3:30 from 4:30. But let me tell you something, it's not just a class. I've been involved in performing arts my whole life, and this is probably the single most rewarding thing I've ever been involved in. The class worldwide, we have over 250 registrants every week, 5 continents. It's really, really amazing. So it's become a singing club, and it's all about the connection. We're singing, we're exercising, we're warming up our bodies, our voices. Every week has a theme, and the participants, it's very active. Unlike this, which is a webinar, we actually can talk to each other and communicate with each other. So they know to, they have a say in the songs that we choose for each theme each week, and they sign on and tell us where they're from and what the temperature is doing, and any holidays or special events, we sing happy birthday, we celebrate. And it is truly, truly a COVID silver lining and something so, so special. And anyone involved in Parkinson, their caregivers, their families are invited to join.
And this is a great way for everyone. If you're out there and you happen to be living alone, or this is a great way that you can join community. And whether it's our program or this program, there's so many offerings. Valerie, can we get a sample of what you guys do?
Absolutely. I'm so thrilled to do that. So tonight, we're going to be doing 2 songs. So December, the month of December seems to be all about connection, obviously, because did you know that there are 27 holidays celebrating during the month of December? However, there is also the onset of winter. And I know that many people have strong feelings about winter. They either love it or they don't, and they make those feelings pretty clear. And so even though some of us around the country have already experienced some of that white stuff, it actually isn't winter yet until next Wednesday, December 21st. So there are many things to love about winter. And I think that this song, written in 1934, will certainly churn our favorite thoughts about winter and all the reasons to love it. So here's what's going to happen. You're going to hear some music. Some lyrics are going to pop up on the screen, and you're going to sing along with me. Are you ready?
I can't wait. Let's do it.
Here we go. Here we go, everyone. Sleigh bells ring. Are you listening? In the lane, snow is glistening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight. A walking in a winter wonderland. Gone away is the bluebird, and here to stay is a new bird. He sings a love song as we go along. A walking in a winter wonderland. In the meadow we can build a snowman and pretend that he is Parson Brown. He'll say, are you married? We'll say, no, man. But you can do the job when you're in town. Later on, we'll conspire as we dream by the fire to face unafraid the plans that we made. Oh, walking in a winter wonderland. In the meadow we can build a snowman and pretend that he's a circus clown. We'll have lots of fun with Mr. Snowman until the other kiddies knock him down. When it snows, ain't it thrilling? Though your nose gets chilling. We'll frolic and play the Eskimo way, a-walking in a winter wonderland. Walking in a winter, walking in a winter, a-walking in a winter wonderland. Good. I hope you all enjoyed that song. Hope we got you into a little bit of the holiday spirit.
Did you sing along?
Yeah. Did you sing along?
Of course.
Now we're coming to the end of our program. And again, we've all been talking about connection and hope. And we're going to close our evening tonight with this next song by the great and gifted Burt Bacharach and Hal David. And perhaps you'll all agree that this song says what we need and want to hear right now. Please bear in mind that it was written in 1965, and yet its message is still most relevant and comforting and connecting. It's a declaration of love, so to say. So please sing along with me. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last till the end of time. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another meadow. There are cornfields and wheat fields enough to grow. There are sunbeams and moonbeams enough to shine. Oh, listen, Lord, if you want to know. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little love. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, oh, but just for everyone. Take the little break, everybody. Take a breath, and we're gonna sing loud. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. One more time. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. Thanks for tuning in, everybody. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Valerie. That is the end of our show. Please remember to check the chat for links to everything we've talked about. Remember, you do not have to face PD alone. The Northwell Health Edmund J. Saffer Wellness Program at the JCC is open to everyone. Whether you want to join us in person or online, we are here for you. We are bringing back everybody here. Broadway Best for Parkinson's is supported by a community grant from the Parkinson's Foundation. So let's give a huge shout out for the Parkinson's Foundation for their support and continuing our grant for a second season. And to David Loud, come back, David, for sharing his journey with us and being so open and honest. Future episodes of Broadway's Best for Parkinson's may include a live studio audience. So if you would like to be in our studio audience, please get a hold of Whitney Chapman, wchapman@mmjccm.org. It's in the chat, and we'll put it on the screen for the replay. A special thank you, of course, to the Marlene Myers and JCC Manhattan, Northwell Health, Jeff Simmons, and Sandra Theras at Arnott Gerstein, our production manager, Whitney Chapman, and our AV team, Sam, Matt, and Jeff. I want to thank all of our guests and invite them to be back on stage with me for a big shout out and to say goodnight. We've had Dr. Alessandro Di Rocco, David Loud, Maria Sirois, Kathleen McKinney, Emma DeLacio, and Nico Charney, Valerie DiLorenzo, and a special get well to those of you that are experiencing COVID right now as one of our presenters, Gloria Lebeaux. She wasn't able to make it tonight because she did come down with COVID. We send you a warm greeting and hope that you are feeling better very, very soon. Thank you, everyone, for sharing your time, your talents, your insights, and mainly for sharing your heart. We'll see you next time. Feel free to unmute, everyone, and wave goodbye.
Thanks, Caroline.